Well, that is because the new world into which Job is born a second time is made up of the shattered remains of the old world in monstrous amalgamation. It lacks all order. And if there is a center to the new world, it is the open wound of the trauma that disorients more than orients and confuses more than clarifies. Allow me to provide a few contemporary analogs to Job's new world after trauma. The new world after trauma is the still crumbling ruin of the old world in the aftermath of an earthquake, where vestiges of church spires, temple stars, and crescent moons poke through the rubble, where you can hear the cry of familiar voices echoing in the hollows below and seeping through the crevices of collapsed buildings, and where rats and rabid dogs dine on buried flesh. The new world is America, home of the brave, land of the free, built in the bloody backs of brothers and sisters bought and sold, dehumanized and demeaned of the slave auction block, and sustained by the erasure of African history and Black history in the hope of erasing the responsibility to face the depth of present sin, and fed by greed and blindness and disdain and gluttony to the point of amnesiac slumber. The new world is our world, in which my mother fears the butt of guns. Children learn to barricade behind school desks, where millions must trade in the plow for the rifle, crayons for missiles, tractors for tanks, and where millions more embark the perilous sea in the faint hope of reaching alien and decidedly unfriendly shores. The new world after trauma is a world too many of us live in today. Job teaches us that the old language of the old world, with its tired explanations for what makes right and what makes wrong, with its feel-good theologies about God who loves but knows not suffering, and who is almighty yet allows a mother to hold too tightly a fading babe in the hollows in the rubble, and with its stale anthropology about image bearers, but which has not reckoned with what we have done with our divine power to create and to destroy. Job teaches us that the old language and its acolytes are incapable of describing, let alone explain, a traumatized world. So Job, as a matter of survival, invents a new language by breaking the old language in an act of breaking the old world. Then he dares speak into being a strange new world in which he is. Is it any wonder that the book of Job, if you have had the chance to read it, contains some of the most difficult poetry in all of Scripture? The difficulty of Job and its relationship to trauma reminds me of the poetry of another poet of trauma, Paul Celan. Paul Celan, the celebrated Jewish German language poet of the past century, was born Paul Anselm to German Jewish parents in Romania in 1920. His mother insisted that they speak German at home, not Romanian, and so German became Celan's native language. In 1941, the Nazi army came to his hometown, and in 1942, his parents were deported to concentration camps. Celan alone managed to escape, initially to a forced labor camp. Later, he would learn of his father's killing by the SS and the execution of his mother, shot through the back of the neck, along with millions of others. Celan subsequently escaped from the labor camp and took refuge in Paris, where he would continue to write poetry and, at the age of 49, jump into La Seine. Paul Celan was fluent in many languages and might have written poetry in any of them, but he chose to write in German because he explains only in one's mother tongue can one express one's own truth. The problem, however, was that German, Paul Celan's mother tongue, was also the language of his mother's murderers, in the language of his father's executioners, in the language of those who sought his annihilation, in the annihilation of European Jewry. That is, Celan's relationship to German was fraught, to say the least. So before he could use the old language to speak his own truth, Celan explains, the language had to pass through its own answerlessness, pass through frightful muting, pass through a thousand darknesses of death-bringing speech. In a real sense, Celan had to risk the death, return to a language animated by the spirit of destructive hatred, and so to the site of his own potential annihilation, all in order to speak of the possibility of life after the frightful muting and the thousand darknesses of death-bringing speech. In short, for Celan to live after the horror, he had to risk death. The result is a body of poetry written in a strange German, strangest to native speakers of German, because Celan's German is in fact a new language, created, to quote one scholar, through a dismantling and a rewelding of German. The old German of the old world, Celan discovers, incapable of describing the world after the Shoah. No, the old had to be broken, bent, and remolded in order that it might speak anew of a strange new world, which is precisely the world the masters of the old language had tried to erase. That is, a world in which Paul Celan and other Jews remain, endure, and continue to live. As my teacher Shoshana Feldman put it, for Celan, the old language had to be dismantled to enact the dismantling of the old world. And only the old language, resurrected in monstrous recombination, could adequately describe the new world after the horror. Is it any wonder that Celan's poetry is among the most difficult in world literature? And so we come back to the difficulty of the poetry of Job. Job is difficult, to be sure, because of its many neologisms and broken grammatical forms, as if searching for new expression capable of describing a new world. But I posit that its genuine difficulty comes from the fact that it breaks traditional forms and ideas to enact their breaking in the face of trauma. In its search for a new explanation, the horror we know is real, and for the possibility that a loving God exists in the face of innocent suffering. What the book gestures toward and begins to express with its new language are new and experimental theologies, anthropologies, and new accounts of creation. We find in the book of Job not the old God of order and law, but a God who is at once more powerful and more vulnerable, more compassionate and yet more distant. We find in it not human beings under the yoke of some rigid moral code, but human beings who are, yes, susceptible to a sea of troubles, but also capable of extraordinary self-determination. And we find in the book of creation, at once more beautiful and more terrible, a creation that has not been domesticated for human wants, but remains wild and awe-inspiring. For you see, hidden in the difficulty of what I have come to think of as the seeds of new beginnings and the seeds of a new world. That is, the book of Job is a gift to the world, especially one that acknowledges and seeks honestly to grapple with the reality of pain and suffering. And at the heart of the gift is its willing participation in the double dynamic of trauma. On the one hand, to testify to the dismantling of the old world, and on the other, to dare imagine the coming into being of a new world in which Job and millions like him remain, endure, and might hope even to flourish. So allow me now to make my final turn and bring us toward home. Job, in the middle of his speeches, and immediately before the rightfully famous confession, "I know that my Redeemer lives," says these words: "Oh, that my words were written down, or that they were inscribed in a book. with an iron pen on his bed, they were engraved on a rock, whatever. Job's words, of course, have been written down and are likely to survive for a very long time, just as he had hoped. But there is one desire which surely motivates his wish for literary preservation that remains perpetually unfulfilled. And that is the desire, the hope, the wish to be heard and to be understood. It is not that no one has read the book of Job carefully or has comprehended it fundamentally. And he has. And I hope we have begun to do so together this morning. But the unfulfilled desire is not about Job per se, but more about the fact that there is always, as McLeish put it in JB, a play based on Job, there is always someone playing Job. Thousands, millions, and millions. Not only in Ukraine, but also in our black and brown communities. Not only in Ohio, but also in California. And not only in our neighbors' homes, but also in our homes. Everywhere, all at once. Just in our country, we began the Lunar New Year with news of a mass shooting in a community dance hall. And before we could digest the news of that tragedy, there was news of a mass shooting at mushroom farms. And before we could digest the news of that tragedy, there was news of five police officers killing a young man on his way to his mother's house. And before we could digest the news of that tragedy, we were distracted by news of rising interest rates, continued inflation, and failed banks. It is hard, it is really hard, sometimes impossible for the traumatized to speak. And even when they do, they can be difficult to understand. They seem to speak of alien landscapes populated by phantasms and monsters, if they speak our language at all. So understandably, and not always out of inconvenience, but sometimes, not always out of sympathy fatigue, but sometimes, and not always out of meanness, but sometimes, we silence the pain and the traumatized, even when they be ourselves. We silence them because when they speak a new language and a new world into being, they enact the destruction of our world, our theologies, and our God. And that, if you're honest, is inconvenient, uncomfortable, and sometimes even maddening. But Job bids us, bids you and me, to bear witness to him, and with him to the thousands, millions, and millions who speak of trauma. We must bear witness to their testimonies, because our survival as individuals, as churches, as the human race, depends on it. Why? How come? Because in a strange way, they are the physicians with the most accurate diagnosis of the sicknesses that would bring death to our churches and our societies, to our families, and to us. Because they are the prophets who carry in their bodies and in their minds the marks of diseased and erased histories and the early symptoms of death. Because with or without words, they tell the terrible truth of our present reality, that the world in which we live is not a world of sound architecture and rigorous workmanship, but a world built on top and with the rubble of the ruins of ancient secrets we would rather forget. We must bear witness, because doing so and doing something about it is the only way that we will be able to fix the rock festering at the center. So now I've brought you into the pit, to a place dark and deep. And my instinct is to announce the coming resurrection. And it is my firm belief that resurrection comes after the cross. If it does not, company among the fools. But let us stay a while longer on the cross.
and linger a few more moments in the grave. Let us study its hellish walls and breathe in more fully the dank, sulfurous air. Let us pace about on the jagged floor and cower before the hornet ceiling. Let us study the hidden histories of trauma on which our world is built. Let us learn how more deeply to yawn and to cry out for help. Let us learn more fully how to speak the language which I have lost. And let us learn to listen to their twisted, tormented silences and their babbling clairvoyance of our future's past. Let us be like Christ, who, having desired that the cup of traumatic death pass from him, nevertheless willingly took up the cross, saying, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not what I want, but what you want." Let us be like Christ, who, having borne the cross in obedience even unto death, learned to speak fluently the language of lament. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, that is, my God, why have you forsaken me? So to those among us who have taken a seat next to Job, as Job, on the ash heap, and cried in woeful lament, I say, look next to you. Christ joins you to lament with you, to yawn with you. He is your faithful friend. He is your God in despair and out of it. To others among us who are fortunate not to have to face a world after trauma, I say to you, look next to you. Christ is lamenting with traumatized brothers and sisters. Go, sit with him. For it is only those who have experienced Christ sitting with them and have sat with Christ in the grave who can with him defeat the forces of death and with him rise to glory. So help us God. Please. Holy One, we speak in tormented silence. We speak jumbled nonsense. We speak our pain and our sorrow in the presence of our fellow and in the blessed presence of our God, who is love and calls us into love. Lord, in your mercy.